If you have your Bibles with you this morning, turn to Luke chapter 19. It is not going to be on the screen this morning with the busyness of everything that's been going on with trying to get facilities in place, getting things ready for Rise Against Hunger. A PowerPoint did not get finished, and I apologize. But there are Bibles in the chair racks in front of you. So if you don't have a Bible, you can take one. And if you don't have a Bible, period, and need a Bible, take it with you. They're free to be taken. So Luke chapter 19, we're going to begin in just a moment with verse 11. Last week we did a drama on the life of Peter. And you heard a little bit of the introduction of Peter's life, where he was from, and then you saw a lot of the emotions of Peter spending that last week of his life with Jesus Christ and the ups and downs that were going on all the way through and how his life was changed because of Jesus Christ. If you read the bulletin with the rest of the story, you see that Peter did have a wife, and they traveled all around she didn't go with him on all of his missionary journeys, but she went with him on several of his missionary journeys to share the change that had happened in their lives and wanting to see other people's changed as well. And according to church history, at the end of Peter's life, he was cast into a prison where he spent 9 months in prison facing torture. And he observed his wife being led out to die for her faith as a martyr. And he encouraged her to be strong in the Lord, to focus on him. And then not long after, he too died for his faith and was martyred in Rome because he loved Christ and wanted to see others come to know him. When you care so much about the lost that you're willing to risk it all. When you care so much about the lost that you're willing to risk it all, you have a heart for the world. Peter had a heart for the world. He risked it all. He gave his life so that we can have the good news today. The early disciples risked their lives and gave their all so that we could have the good news today. And on through the centuries, men and women have done that. That's what relentlessly pursuing God and the people that he loves is all about. There is absolutely no question. There is absolutely no question that God cares about people. Pastor Darren shared about 3 weeks ago about God sharing for people. There is no doubt the importance that we play to him. I mean, we are so important to him that he gave his only son to bring reconciliation so that there could be a reunion between God and man, because the relationship had been broken for years, and Jesus Christ restored that relationship. There is certainly no question that God has a desire to have a relationship with every man and woman that has ever been born and ever will born. Jesus explained in his mission statement that he had came to seek and to save those who are lost. Those who do not have a relationship with Jesus Christ. You can think of individuals now that don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ. Family members, friends, coworkers. I know several. Your beautician, your barber, your banker, the grocery store clerk. Those individuals. Jesus cared so much about lost people. He cared so much about them that he gave his entire life for them. He spent his entire life striving to find a solution to help lost people be found. And he calls us to do the same. When you care so much about the lost that you're willing to risk it all, you have a heart for the world. I don't know if you've ever heard of the name Rick Rescorla. But Rick Rescorla was an individual who predicted the tragedy that took place on 9/11 almost 16 years ago. It'd be 16 years this September. Long before September 11, 2001 took place, Rick Rescorla, the 60-year-old head of security for the Morgan Stanley Bank, developed an evacuation plan for the bank. The bank officers were situated in the South Tower of the World Trade Center, and Rick was convinced that Osama bin Laden would use jet planes to try to destroy the World Trade Center. The plan and its preparation were hugely unpopular. Rick's plan and preparation was hugely unpopular with the Morgan Stanley staff. Many of them thought that Rick was some sort of madman that was crazy with when he was predicting some of the things that would take place. On September 11th, 2001, American Airlines Flight 11 hit the World Trade Center Tower 1 at 8:46 a.m. Rick ignored the building officials' advice to stay put and began evacuation procedures for the Morgan Stanley employees. 2,800 employees on 20 floors of the World Trade Center of Tower 2, and 1,000 employees in World Trade Center 5. Rick reminded everyone to be proud that they were Americans. And he said that tomorrow everyone will be talking for you, talking about you. As he encouraged them as they were evacuating, he sang songs like God Bless America and other types of songs, trying to get them to get out of the building in an effective manner without being all crazy. And by the time that Flight 175 hit World Trade Center Building Number 2 at 9:07 a.m., everyone from Morgan Stanley part of the World Trade Center building was out safe. After having reached safety, Rick returned to the building to rescue others still inside that weren't with Morgan Stanley. He was last seen headed up the stairs to the 10th floor of the collapsing World Trade Center 2. His remains were never recovered. Because of Rick's actions, only 6 Morgan Stanley employees out of the 2,800 in the World Trade Center were killed on September 11th, 2001. And those that were killed included Rick and 3 of his deputies who followed him back into the building to rescue those that were there. Morgan Stanley Bank employees who once thought Rick was a madman and crazy were now in tears praising him because of saving their lives from total destruction. Had they followed the advice of others, many more would have lost their lives. Many felt so guilty and apologetic that they thought Rick was some madman and crazy for continuing to preach and warn and put all these places things and these procedures that would protect them in place. They felt guilty over the things that they had said. Yet now, they were extremely appreciative. What if Rick had not been willing to go back into the building? What if Rick had not gotten those 2,800 employees out? What if Rick would have gave in to the opposition when people were saying, "You're a madman, it'll never happen," and he just dropped it and never did anything and remained silent. Rick believed in his cause, and the cause was more important than what people thought about him. Rick believed in his cause, and the cause was more important than what people thought about him. For a time, he was thought to be crazy, but history will have him down as being a hero for the lives that were saved. When you care so much about the lost that you're willing to risk it all, you'll have a heart for the world. When you care so much about the lost that you're willing to risk it all, that's when you have a heart for the world. When you're willing to relentlessly pursue God and the people that He loves, you're fulfilling the mission, the great commission that Jesus Christ has given us, the job that He has given us to do. And that is what Luke chapter 19 is all about. It's about individuals that were willing to risk it all willing to risk it all. In Luke chapter 19, beginning with verse 11, it says, "The crowd was listening to everything Jesus said, and because he was nearing Jerusalem, he told them a story to correct the impression that the kingdom of God would begin right away. He said, 'A nobleman was called away to a distant empire to be crowned king and then return. Before he left, he called together 10 other servants and divided them among the 10 pounds of silver, saying, "Invest this for me while I'm gone." But his people hated him and sent a delegation after him to say, "We do not want him to be our king." After he was crowned king, he returned and called in the servants to whom he had given the money. He wanted to find out what their profits were. The first servant reported, "Master, I have invested your money and have made..." "Master, I have invested your money and made 10 times the original amount." Verse 17. "Well done," the king exclaimed. "You are a good servant. You have been faithful with the little I have entrusted to you. You will be governor of 10 of your cities, or the cities, as a reward." Verse 18. The next servant replied, "Master, I have invested your money and made 5 times the original amount." "Well done," the king said. "You will be governor over 5 cities." But the third servant brought back only the original amount of money and said, "Master, I hid your money and kept it safe. I was afraid because you are a hard man to deal with in taking what isn't yours and harvesting crops you didn't plant." "You wicked servant," the king replied. "Your words condemn you. If you knew that I'm a hard man who takes what isn't mine and harvests crops I didn't plant, why didn't you deposit my money into the bank? At least I could have gotten some interest on it." Then turning to the others nearby, the king ordered, "Take the money from this servant and give it to the one that has 10 pounds. Verse 25. "But master," they said, "he already has 10 pounds. "Yes," the king replied, "and to those who use well what they are given, even more will be given. But for those who do nothing, even what little they have will be taken away. And as for the enemies of mine who didn't want me to be their king, bring them in and execute them right here in front of me." There's a lot of different analogies and stories and illustrations we could pull out of this. And I'm not going to get into all the different ones. But in this story, I'm going to focus on one. Those that were willing to risk it all. The two that were willing to risk it all. In the story, the nobleman gives a sum of money to 10 different servants. The money represents what we are doing with the gifts that God has given to us. Because God has given each of us who are believers in Jesus Christ gifts. We are blessed. And it's a responsibility for us as Christians to take the good news of Jesus Christ and to reach out to minister to each other and to reach out to the world that is lost, to the people that he cares about. As we plan our days and we prioritize our lives, what we need to keep in mind is the fact that we are going to have to one day give an account before God for the gifts that we have been given, for how we have managed the talents and the gifts and all that we have. And don't say, "Well, I don't have much," because we in America, even those that are on welfare, I've used this illustration multiple times, and if you've been around for any period of time, you know it. Even those that are on welfare are wealthier than 2/3 of the rest of the world. We have much in this life, in this country. And we will give account for how we have used what God has given to us, how we have the resources, our talents, our time. We will stand before God and give an account. In the story, the first servant, he was willing to give it all, to invest it all. He took a risk and ended up getting back 10 times more the original amount. The second servant, he invested it all and ended up getting back 5 times more. The third servant wasn't willing to take any risk at all. He didn't do anything with it other than bury it. And those, the first two, because of their faithfulness, because of they were willing to take a risk and give it all, they were rewarded exponentially for what they had done. And when we are willing to give it all for the kingdom, we will be rewarded exponentially, because every single one of us will have to stand before God one day and give account for what we have done with how He has what He has entrusted to us. Now, I know this morning, I know that works do not save us. It's through grace. Ephesians 2 and 8 and 9 says, "For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is a gift of God, not of works, so that no man can boast." We cannot work our way into heaven. But when we begin to realize what it cost Jesus Christ, what it cost God giving His own Son to die on the cross for us, that sacrifice, what it cost Jesus Christ when He gave His life to die on the cross, the sacrifice. When we realize how much love that He had and has for us, we will in turn want to reach out in love and be obedient and do things to make a difference to a world that desperately needs Him. I know that works don't save us, but as a believer in Jesus Christ, to whom much is given, much is required. And in James, it says, "What good is it, dear brothers and sisters, if you say you have faith but don't show it by your actions? Can that kind of faith save anyone? Suppose you see a brother or sister who has no food or clothing, and you say, 'Goodbye, have a good day, stay warm and eat well,' but then you don't give that person any food or clothing? What good does it do? So you see, faith by itself isn't enough. Unless it produces good deeds, it is dead and useless." See, that's why we are going to El Salvador in June. Because Christ has done so much for us, we want to give back. That's why we are preparing over 10,000 meals today to send to Haiti, because Christ has done so much for us and we want to give back. That's why we prepared the blessing bags that we prepared here back in December to give out to the homeless around. That's why we do the outreach events that we do around. That's why next Sunday we're having Palm Sunday Friends Day. And we're inviting you to invite friends to come that don't go to other churches. And for the children, there'll be an Easter egg hunt. And we're having a potluck dinner. And you can read in the little bulletin card thing that was given out to you about what to bring and how you can make a difference. But more than bringing food, more than the Easter eggs hunt, we want to encourage you to invite individuals that don't go to church to come. Why? Because we care about lost people. Because, Lord willing, you care about lost people. You care about the people that live around you. You care about your family, your coworkers, your friends. That's what it is all about. That's why we do the things that we do to reach out into our community. That's why we open our facility up to the people in the community, because we care about lost people. And if lost people matter to Jesus Christ, they should matter to us. When we relentlessly pursue God and the people that He loves, we will be like the two servants that were willing to risk it all and receive a return. We will have the passion to see lost people found. We'll be on fire for Jesus Christ. We will burn passionately for Him. Fire is not easily contained, but ashes are. Fire is not easily contained, but ashes are. When Christians are so ignited that we relentlessly pursue God and the people He loves, we're going to set other people on fire as well. It is easy to determine when something is on fire because it spreads. Here a week ago, I was outside and living right along a woods. I was trying to clean some of the brush out next to the woods so that if there's ever a forest fire, it's not coming close to the house. And we could also see into the woods and also helps keep the varmints from coming up close to the house so that we don't have to worry about our chickens being attacked or anything like that. And so I had some of this brush and I had a small fire going and I was putting wood on and I was burning it and it was right underneath a tree limb. And I was keeping the fire pretty small until I put this one evergreen brush that I cut down on it and it started flaming up. And the next thing I know, I look up and there's this limb that's on fire on the tree. Because fire spreads. Thankfully, it was raining and it went out pretty quickly. It didn't have enough fuel. But that's the way it is when we are a Christian. When we're so passionate about Jesus Christ, it will blaze up and it will spread to others. And we will want to share. If you get a fire blazing hot, it doesn't matter what kind of water you put on it. It basically just makes it evaporate. We need to be so passionate for Jesus Christ that others, that Satan can't put out our fire, that others can't put out our fires, that we're willing to do whatever, to risk it all. That's what Rick did when he went into the building. He put the evacuation stuff together. He didn't care what people think. And even though people ridiculed him, later on, they were thanking him. People may ridicule you because of your faith, because of your passion for Jesus Christ. But in the end, if they accept it and they begin to believe, they will thank you later on for your persistence, for your love, for your care, that you were relentlessly pursuing him. Any fire that does not spread will eventually die out. A church without a heart for the lost will die out. We have got to have a greater heart. And the church is not just me or Pastor Darren. The church is each of us here this morning, the body of Jesus Christ. Are you willing to risk it all to see others come into a relationship with Jesus Christ? Because when you care about the world so much that you're willing to risk it all, that's when you have a heart for the world. And that's the type of heart that God is desiring for each of us to have. I believe God wants to do some exciting things in this church. He's already done a lot of exciting things, but I believe the most exciting days are still ahead. I have been saying it come this June for 16 years. And I've seen a lot of lives changed in those 16 years. Some of those individuals are in home, in heaven with Jesus Christ. Some of them are in ministry or gone on to other churches, but their lives that have been changed, and many of them are here that are part of our congregation. May we be concerned about lost people just as Jesus Christ was concerned and is concerned about lost people. May we be willing to risk it all no matter what. Amen. Would you stand with me this morning? Father, thank you for your incredible love again for us. Thank you that you gave Jesus Christ for us. And Lord, I pray that you would help us to stop making excuses for not caring about people, because it's easy. It's easy for me to make excuses. And I'm a pastor. So if it's easy for me, I'm sure it's easy for others. But you have called us all. Some you have given the gift of evangelism. But to all of us, you've told us to go. We can reach out with the love of Christ. And may we be willing to risk it all. Risk being humiliated. Risk being rejected. Risk being alienated so that the gospel, the love that you have extended to us will be shared with others. Thank you. Thank you for extending that love to us. Thank you for what Easter represents. Thank you that it's the one day that sets us apart from every other world religion. Because you cannot go to the tomb of Jesus Christ to find him there. He is alive and well, and he's here in our presence. I thank you for being here. And now, may the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be yours. May he burn within you and set your heart ablaze for him. And may you share with others the hope that Jesus Christ offers. And may his love indwell within you and engulf you. And may his peace reign supreme in your life, both now and forevermore. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we pray. And all God's people said, Amen. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve.